This video is sponsored by Squarespace. The next total lunar eclipse is just 2 weeks away. Here on the east coast of the US, the party starts just before midnight on March 13th and wraps up at 6 a.m. March 14th. And the most important part, the totality phase, where the full moon turns a reddish-orange color, lasts from 2:30 a.m. to 3:30 a.m. here in New Hampshire. So it's a late night eclipse for sure, but is it worth it to stay up and actually check this out? I think so. It's a really neat event, and if you haven't seen it before, definitely it's worth it, and you won't actually get another total lunar eclipse here in the eastern United States until June 2029. So that's a pretty long wait for another opportunity to see it. So even if you have to set an alarm and wake up in the middle of the night to see that red moon, I think it will be worth it. So what is a total lunar eclipse? This kind of eclipse occurs when our planet, the Earth, is lined up between the sun and the moon so that the moon is completely in the darkest part of the Earth's shadow called the umbra. And that means it's getting no direct sunlight, but some indirect sunlight is still getting through, but it's impacted by our atmosphere, which treats different wavelengths of light differently. So the reason the moon appears reddish-orange during totality is the same reason a sunset appears reddish-orange. And you can even think of a total lunar eclipse as all of the Earth's sunsets and sunrises at that time being projected onto the moon's surface, which, if you think of it from the moon's vantage point, would appear as like a ring of red, being the Earth's atmosphere, around the eclipsed Earth. And what's especially cool about this is every total lunar eclipse will actually be slightly different due to different amounts of water vapor and particulate matter in the Earth's atmosphere. And this shows up directly in the color and especially the brightness of the total lunar eclipse at totality. So some total lunar eclipses will be darker and a little muddier, and others will be much more bright and vibrant. You can see that in this comparison. I think the 2019 one was definitely a brighter lunar eclipse, while 2022 was a darker one. So it's always exciting for me to see the flavor, you know, of total lunar eclipse that we're gonna get. Now, a total lunar eclipse is never visible for everyone on Earth, and this one is mostly going to be good for North and South America, the Western Hemisphere. My favorite website for checking this out and future eclipses too is timeanddate.com. As you can see, it has a very nice map that you can visualize the various eclipses, and then there's a table here for this specific eclipse that will update for your time zone, and that's important for when the important phases will start and end. This one will last about 6 hours, but visually and photographically, I think it doesn't really get interesting until the partial phase starts about an hour in. That's when you start seeing the shadow of the Earth sort of taking a bite out of the moon that gets progressively bigger until it's completely covering it up. And then when totality hits, that's when it turns more red. You don't need any specialized equipment to view the total lunar eclipse. You can just view it naked eye, which was the first few times I saw it, that's all I did. I didn't have anything with me. It was still a lot of fun to see it. But if you do have a telescope or binoculars, I'd recommend getting them out, taking a look, because one of my favorite aspects of a total lunar eclipse is it's the only time visually when you're looking through an eyepiece and you're looking at the nice close-up of the moon with all the crater details that you can see the background stars around the moon at the same time that you're seeing the full moon. And because usually the glare of the bright full moon completely will obscure our ability to see those stars around it. And there's something about that that's just really cool to see that through either binoculars or a telescope. Both are really nice. Of course, you're only going to be able to see the eclipse at all if the skies are not overcast with clouds as they are now. And March isn't typically the best month for clear skies here in New Hampshire, so I'll be looking at my astronomy-specific weather forecasts like the Astrospheric app, and this will help me plan because maybe I can take a short drive to find clearer skies. And to do that, you can just check out this map here in Astrospheric, and it gives you the forecasted cloud cover in your area. Now, if you want to photograph the eclipse, of course, this is an astrophotography channel, any kind of camera that you have available to you will get some kind of photo of it. Even if you just are using a smartphone, If it's a modern smartphone, these days they have really nice night modes that will sort of kick in automatically. They stack several images together automatically, and so that's gonna get a nice picture of the eclipse. You'll just wanna zoom in all the way and probably try to stabilize your phone in some way, either just having it on something like a rock or something, or if you have a cell phone tripod, that would be ideal. If you do have regular astrophotography gear, then you have a number of options, of course, for how to capture the eclipse. I would say if you have a star tracker or tracking mount like this one, use it because it's very useful for keeping the moon centered in frame. But also, you'll likely, during totality, want to take longer exposures. Now, exactly how long depends on how dark this particular eclipse is. But in every eclipse that I've shot, I've wanted to do exposures at least 1 to 2 seconds long. And even at 1 to 2 seconds long, if you're at a high focal length, you'll get some motion blur from the Earth's rotation if you're not using a tracker. Or tracking mount. Now, if you don't have a tracker, don't despair. What you can do instead is just lower your exposure, your shutter speed, until you get very nice sharp pictures, and then just raise the ISO. And by doing that, by taking shorter pictures, your pictures are gonna be noisier. But what then you can do is you can stack a bunch of these shorter exposures together to improve the signal to noise ratio. And I have a video on stacking lunar eclipse images that you can follow along for stacking. And I actually show a slightly complicated process in that called a double stack process so that you can get nice detail on both the eclipsed moon and the background stars, but you don't have to do the background stars part. The video could still be useful for just stacking your pictures of the lunar eclipse. Okay, some other tips. If you're using a DSLR or mirrorless camera, definitely remember to shoot raw, because if you're just taking a single picture, JPEG might be fine, but you'll get a lot more latitude if you do want to do some post-processing if you shoot raw. If you are a smart telescope user, I would definitely give that a try. I think this will be my first time trying a smart telescope on the total lunar eclipse, but I did try it on the past total solar eclipse and it worked really well. If you want to try that, I would just suggest using the lunar imaging mode in the app and try auto exposure. If for some reason auto exposure isn't working to your satisfaction, you can just pull up manual exposure and adjust it live. You have plenty of time with a total lunar eclipse. Like I said, totality lasts about an hour with this one, so you'll be fine there. Now, in my series on total solar eclipse imaging, I covered eclipse-specific automation software, and there is eclipse-specific automation software for the total lunar eclipse as well. For instance, if you have a Canon camera and a Windows laptop, you can use Let-in-See, and Naz over at Nastronomy YouTube channel has already put together a great tutorial on this total lunar eclipse where he covers Let-in-See in detail, and I'll link that in the description. Another thing to perhaps try, and I may try it for this upcoming one, is shooting real-time video. And one of the reasons this occurs to me is during the 2019 total lunar eclipse, the first one I photographed, there was a meteorite impact on the moon that was very bright, but also incredibly brief, of course, just a blip. So if you want your best chance to capture something like that, real-time video of all of totality would be the wisest choice there. And to be clear, it's not super likely, from what I've heard, that with any single total lunar eclipse that we'll see another meteorite impact like we did in 2019, but it's always possible. And real-time video gives you a much better chance of capturing something like that because it's so fleeting. And with regular photography, it's unlikely that you would be taking a picture just at that very moment. If you are able to capture the total lunar eclipse, what should you do with your photos? Well, I'd suggest putting them up on your own website, and that's where today's sponsor comes in, Squarespace. The nice thing about having your own website is you can make it look however you want. You have complete control over the design, and Squarespace makes that easy thanks to their design system called Squarespace Blueprint. You'll find that there's a template that fits whatever your needs are, and it's easy to customize that template to make it your own. So I have a fairly simple gallery-based website that shows off my photography very well. But if you need a website to be more of an online store, all of that is built into Squarespace and ready to go. Whether you're selling like a physical product, a print, a service, Squarespace has categories for all of that, and customers can pay, you know, however works best for them, using PayPal, credit card, Afterpay. So if you'd like to give this a try, head to squarespace.com/nebulaphotos for a free trial. And when ready to make a purchase of hosting our domain, use code nebulaphotos for 10% off. Till next time, this has been Nico Carver. Clear skies for the total lunar eclipse.